Good morning, everyone. I'm Dan Gorodnik, Chair of the Planning Commission. Welcome to today's public meeting. It is September 7th, 2022. I hear the church bells. It is officially 10 o'clock. We're glad to have you all with us. As for today's agenda, it is short and to the point. After we call the roll, vote on the minutes, we're going to start with some votes. Including on a New York City Department of Housing Preservation and Development proposal to build about 700 affordable homes in East New York. This project, which is screaming for a new name, is called Gateway Site 26A and Phase 5. Sending that over to the marketing department. We also have votes on a new apartment building project on 9th Street in Gowanus and several small Staten Island applications. We are then going to have a single public hearing on a four-building development, which would bring about 300 homes, 90 of them affordable, and retail space to Borum Hill, and also quite close to the Atlantic Avenue Barclays Transit Hub in Brooklyn. The site is at 280 Bergen Street. And that's it for today. So it should be not too long a day for the commission. And I'm going to ask Ryan to walk us through how the public may participate on our public hearing today. And again, welcome to all.
Yes. So good morning. Verbal testimony may be provided online or by calling in on your telephone. If you wish to speak, you must register through the NYC Engage portal. So register through the upcoming meetings page of the NYC Engage portal. A link to join the hearing is on the landing page after you register. So don't close that landing page without first clicking on the link. If you wish to access the hearing via phone and want to speak, you must first register with the dial-in participant hotline at the numbers listed on the screen. If one of the numbers is busy, please try another one. The meeting ID is 618-237-7396. Press pound to skip the participation ID, and the password is the numeral 1. The phone number is also posted on the upcoming meetings page of the NYC Engage portal. Note that no matter how you're accessing the meeting, you must register if you want to speak. Those accessing the meeting online will have the option to turn on their camera while giving testimony. So when it is your turn to speak, you'll be notified and promoted to a panelist. This will allow you to unmute your microphone and grant you the ability to turn on your camera. Listen closely for your name to be called. There will be a short period where it will appear you're no longer in the meeting. Don't be alarmed. You should rejoin the meeting as a panelist. If you're accessing the hearing via phone, your name will be called from a list of registered speakers. Once your name has been called, you are given the ability to unmute yourself. You do this by pressing *6 to unmute your phone. For those listening to the hearing through the online live stream who wish to speak, you must first register to speak through the upcoming meetings page. It's not possible to testify through the online live stream. Likewise, for those accessing the hearing via phone who wish to speak, they must also register through the dial-in participant hotline that I described a moment ago. Speakers are limited to 3 minutes of testimony. There are a few exceptions to that. Elected officials are accorded the courtesy of jumping to the front of the queue and are not limited to 3 minutes. If consecutive translation services are being used, the time will be extended to 5 minutes. And if an applicant team with three or more speakers wishes to make a team presentation, the team will generally be allowed a total of 10 minutes. The chair will announce when the time limit is reached. Be mindful of potential background noise during your testimony. Make sure that if you're watching the proceedings via live stream, that the live stream is muted when you begin your testimony. Otherwise, you will hear an echo. And if you wish to submit written testimony, it should be submitted to the Department of City Planning. The mailing and email addresses can be found on our website, planning.nyc.gov. And note that this remote public hearing is being recorded.
Excellent. Thank you, Ryan, as always. And again, welcome to everybody to the City Planning Commission's remote public meeting. And let's get the ball rolling. Madam Secretary, please go ahead and start the meeting for us.
Chair Gorodnik, good morning. Oh. And I will be covering for Madam Secretary this morning.
Okay, my apologies. Mr. Secretary, please.
Indeed. Good morning, Chair Gorodnik. Good morning, Commissioners. Good morning, all. Welcome to the City Planning Commission remote public meeting held through the NYC Engage portal. Today is Wednesday, September 7th, 2022. I will now call the roll. Chair Gorodnik.
Here.
Vice Chair Knuckles.
Here.
Commissioner Bozorg.
Here.
Commissioner Burney.
Here.
Commissioner Cerullo.
Here.
Commissioner Dweck.
Here.
Commissioner Eady.
Here.
Commissioner Gold.
Here.
Commissioner Goodridge.
Here.
Commissioner Kimani.
Here.
Commissioner Marin.
Here.
Commissioner Osorio.
Here.
Commissioner Rampachat.
Here.
A quorum is present. The first item is the approval of the minutes of the public meeting of Wednesday, August 24th, 2022.
Thank you very much. On the minutes, I make a motion to approve the minutes of Wednesday, August 24, 2022. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? Thank you. Minutes are approved.
Commissioners, the next part of the calendar is the reports section on page 4. Reports, Borough of Brooklyn, calendar numbers 1 and 2, CD5, calendar number 1, C220405HAK, calendar number 2, C220-2406-HUK. In a matter of an application for UDAP designation, project approval, and disposition of city-owned property, and an amendment to an urban renewal plan concerning Gateway Site 26A and Phase 5. For favorable reports on calendars numbers 1 and 2, Chair Gorodnik.
Vote aye.
Vice Chair Knuckles.
Yes.
Commissioner Bozorg.
Yes.
Commissioner Burney.
Yes.
Commissioner Cerullo.
Yes.
Commissioner Dweck.
Yes.
Commissioner Eady.
Yes.
Commissioner Gold.
Yes.
Commissioner Goodridge.
Yes.
Commissioner Kermani.
Yes.
Commissioner Marin.
Yes.
Commissioner Osorio.
Yes.
Commissioner Rampachat.
Yes.
Favorable reports have been adopted on calendar numbers 1 and 2. Borough Brooklyn, calendar numbers 3 through 5, CD6, calendar number 3, C210-348-ZMK, calendar number 4, N210-349-ZRK, calendar number 5, C210-350-ZSK. In a matter of an application for zoning map and zoning text amendments and a special permit, for favorable reports on calendars numbers 3, 4, and 5, Chair Gorodnik.
Aye.
Vice Chair Knuckles.
Yes.
Commissioner Bozorg.
Yes.
Commissioner Burney.
Yes.
Commissioner Cerullo.
Yes.
Commissioner Dweck.
Yes.
Commissioner Eady.
Yes.
Commissioner Gold.
Yes.
Commissioner Goodridge.
Yes.
Commissioner Kermani.
Yes.
Commissioner Marin.
Yes.
Commissioner Osorio.
Yes.
Commissioner Rampachat.
Yes.
Favorable reports have been adopted on calendars numbers 3, 4, and 5. Borough of Staten Island, calendar numbers 6, 7, and 8. Calendar number 6, CD3, N220-344-RCR, Sheldon Avenue. Calendar number 7, CD3, N220-387-RCR, Richard Avenue. Calendar number 8, CD2, N220-397-ZCR, 280 Benedict Road. In a matter of applications for the grant of certifications concerning Sheldon Avenue, Richard Avenue, and 280 Benedict Road, for adoption on calendars numbers 6, 7, and 8. Chair Gorodnik.
Vote aye.
Vice Chair Knuckles.
Yes.
Commissioner Bozorg.
Yes.
Commissioner Burney.
Yes.
Commissioner Cerullo.
Yes.
Commissioner Dweck.
Yes.
Commissioner Eady.
Yes.
Commissioner Gold.
Yes.
Commissioner Goodridge.
Yes.
Commissioner Kimani.
Yes.
Commissioner Marin.
Yes.
Commissioner Osorio.
Yes.
Commissioner Rampachat.
Yes.
Calendar numbers 6, 7, and 8 have been adopted. Thank you, commissioners. The next part of the calendar is the public hearing section on page 7.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Again, we ask those who are testifying to limit remarks to 3 minutes. I'm going to ask you, Mr. Secretary, to call the first item here.
With pleasure, Chair Gorodnik. Borough of Brooklyn, calendar numbers 9 and 10, CD2, calendar number 9, C220188ZMK, calendar number 10, N220189ZRK. A public hearing in a matter of an application for zoning map and zoning text amendments concerning 280 Bergen Street rezoning.
Great. Thank you very much. And let me note that we have an applicant team presentation, which will be entitled to 10 minutes for 280 Bergen Street. The team includes Dan Egers, Nancy Dune, J. Richard Dillon, David West, Jay Siegel, and Sean Dawson. So the applicant team, we are ready for you, and the presentation is up. So whenever you are ready, you can go ahead and proceed.
Thank you so much, Chair Gorodnik. Good morning, and good morning all to the commissioners as well. Dan Eggers, land use attorney at Greenberg Clark. I will be introducing the site and the requested actions. Then David West, the project architect, will present the contemplated development, and my colleague Jay Siegel will discuss our responses to the feedback we received from the community and the borough president and certain comments from yesterday's review session. And here to answer questions is Rich Dillon, representing ownership, and Nancy Dune from BHB. Next slide. This is an application by an affiliate of the Ulano Corporation to rezone the western portion of the block bounded by Nevin Street, 3rd Avenue, Bergen Street, and Wyckoff Street in Borum Hill. So it's all in a residential zoning district and the map MIH options 1 and 2 over the rezoned area. Next slide. As you can see, this is the only manufacturing zone block in this area. The M12 was put in place in the early 1970s in connection with the Bergen Street Urban Renewal Plan to allow the expansion of Ulano. Ulano manufactures screen printing materials. The block's 3rd Avenue frontage was recently rezoned from an M12 district to a R7D C24 district with one mid-block lot in an R6B district for a project at 98 3rd Avenue. Next slide, please. This shows our development site and the site of the 3rd Avenue rezoning. Next slide. The lots in yellow are owned by Ulano, which total 50,700 square feet and are approved with the 1 and 2 story buildings I showed you in the photo. Ulano and its predecessors have been on this block since the 1920s. Ulano has been there since the early 1970s. It requested the rezoning to the M12 district in the 70s then so it could expand. Ulano is now shifting operations to facilities in Texas and Germany. Ulano also leases 2 parcels from the city, totaling about 20,000 square feet, controlled by HPD, pursuant to a 1973 lease, which are shown here in pink. These parcels are used for accessory parking. Ulano's lease is more than 40 years remaining. The 2 HPD parcels are not part of our client's proposed development. One was rezoned as part of the 3rd Avenue application, and the other is part of our proposed rezoned area. Next slide. Here you see photos of the project area. Next slide, please. It's a view along Bergen Street. Development site is on the left. Next slide. Shows the Wyckoff Street frontage of the development site. And next slide. This is from Wyckoff Street looking east. Next slide. And once again, this is the tax map showing the existing zoning to orient us. Next slide, please. We are proposing to eliminate the remainder of the M12 district and map an R7A district in this place. Note that one parcel of ours in the mid-block lot 42 would be rezoned to R7A from the R6B mapped under the 3rd Avenue rezoning. This change would result in about 6 additional dwelling units. The full rezoning area would be mapped for MIH. A portion of the project would be in the R7D C24 district mapped under the 3rd Avenue rezoning. The R7D with MIH allows for development of up to 5.6 FAR, and the R7A with MIH allows for up to 4.6 FAR. We believe the proposed R7A district creates a transition to the lower density areas of Borum Hill. Specifically, the rezoning is designed such that the development site would create a transition area between the 180-foot tall Wyckoff Garden buildings to the south, 3rd Avenue to the east, and the lower density residential neighborhoods to the west and north. I now turn it over to David West.
Thank you, Dan. Can we have the next slide, please? Good morning. Here's an illustrative rendering that shows the preliminary design of the project. Along Bergen Street, which has 400 feet of frontage, we would employ several architectural devices to break down the scale, both vertically and horizontally, while still maintaining a consistent vocabulary throughout. The facade is shaped into a gentle sawtooth configuration. This breaks the facade down into a series of 50-foot planes, which will provide vertical articulation. By using the dormer rules, we've varied the height and setback and shifted the emphasis towards the eastern end of the site, towards Third Avenue. Horizontally, we break the height into three packages with changes of material and horizontal emphasis at the fourth floor and the seventh floor. The lowest of these three tiers aligns with the brownstones to the west and is accentuated with a setback shoulder facing west. This datum carries across the facade. The material below this line is predominantly brick. The middle package from the fifth to the seventh floor retains the punched window aesthetic, but is rendered in lighter colors with less depth of reveal in the facade. The upper package, floors 8 to 9, will be glassier and more transparent. This tier is above the setback. We've used a patterning of vertical and horizontal mullions to give this area scale and avoid an all glass look, but still keep it light. Next slide, please. This shows the same building from the Third Avenue end of the block, showing the residential entry. Next slide. This building is a separate building on Wyckoff Street that could be up to 9 stories. Next slide. These are our illustrative massings that show the maximum sized buildings that could be constructed in the mid-block. The R7A district with MIH sets the maximum base height at 75 feet, at which height a 15-foot setback is required from narrow streets and a maximum height of 95 feet for 9 stories. The rezoning could allow the development site to be redeveloped with 4 new buildings. A 9-story building on Bergen Street would contain approximately 250 dwelling units, as well as ground floor and cellar retail and community facility uses. A smaller 9-story building fronting on Wyckoff Street would contain approximately 46 units. 2 3- to 5-story townhouse type buildings, one on each side of the block's R6B district, would contain up to 3 to 5 units each. Next slide, please. Altogether, the contemplated development would contain approximately 238,420 square feet of floor area, including approximately 10,000 square feet of commercial space, including 5,000 square feet of cellar space, 5,000 square feet of community facility floor space, and 228,260 square feet of residential floor area. The proposed development would contain approximately 300 dwelling units in all. In response to the borough president's comments regarding sustainability, the owner developer has committed to designing the building to LEED standards. It's too early to commit to a specific certification path, but we're very familiar with the various certification paths, and we are incorporating into most of our new buildings a much higher level of sustainability than was the case even a few years ago. For example, it's likely the building will be predominantly or perhaps all electric, will employ a highly efficient exterior envelope and include green roofs. The rear yard will be landscaped and may well serve as a stormwater infiltration area. However, it's too early in design to commit to an overly specific approach. These matters must be worked through with specialized consultants. And we intend to improve the streetscape with new tree planting to the maximum extent feasible. With that, I'd like to turn it back to Jay, right?
It is Jay, thank you. I see I only have 1 minute to respond to the community board and the borough president's concerns, and I'll do my best. And if somebody were to ask me a question to respond to what I haven't responded to yet, I'll be happy to be more complete. The community board had three major concerns. One is they felt our 125 space garage for almost entirely for required parking was unnecessary because of the site's proximity to mass transit. There are many subway lines, bus lines, and a railroad. They felt that the affordability was not deep enough, and they thought that the nine stories in the mid-block were too tall. Regarding required parking, even though a parking garage would provide income to Alano and be an amenity to some tenants, we saw their point. The site is very close to a lot of mass transit, and so we've started the process to eliminate the required parking obligation so we could eliminate the garage. Regarding affordability, most of the discussion has been focused on the 20,000 square feet of lots leased from HPD.
Your time is up. So I will pose the question to you because we do want to hear your response on this, but I just want to officially note the time is up. So Mr. Siegel, go ahead and tell us the response on affordability and also on the mid-block. Yeah, which was a question that I wanted to ask you about anyway. So go ahead.
Thank you, Chair Gorodnik. Well, regarding affordability, most of the discussion has been focused on the 20,000 square feet of HPD lots. Council Member Ressler had made it clear to us that he would not consider supporting our application unless we agreed to forego the 40 years remaining on our lease term, and that HPD would agree that they would expeditiously RFP the site to be redeveloped with 100% affordable housing. And we are in discussions with the council member and with HPD and with DCAS to effectuate this concept. Point out that if this happens, the HPD lots that are now leased from HPD could be redeveloped with about 100 affordable units. Taken together with the 90 that you heard proposed for our site, we had almost 200 affordable units that would be generated by the project, along with the 210 market rate units that would be in our project. The last comment about the height and mid-block, we recognize the concern that the community board issued about the nine stories, but we point out that the proximity to mass transit, in addition to providing an opportunity to eliminate required parking, also provides an excellent opportunity to have some density to provide much needed housing in the area. And this fact was recognized by the Boreham Hill Association. Their president spoke at the community board hearing and he expressed an issue with the nine stories, but he said, if the project were to provide deep affordable housing, that he would be okay with the nine stories. And we think that it's a good solution to everything, to have extra density in the mid-block, given its location to mass transit and to the total project's benefit. There was a comment made both by the borough president, by one of the commissioners yesterday, about consulting with Wyckoff Gardens concerning the use of the community space. I want to explain to the commission that the council member Ressler has put together a group consisting of Wyckoff Gardens and of 572 Warren Street Housing and other local people and members of the community board and the council member, and to discuss many issues, including this one. And we met once and we have another meeting scheduled to next week. And so we are going to address that issue.
Okay. Great, thank you. Let me just circle back on a couple of those items. On the mid-block density question, obviously I'm not interested in reducing the amount of density on the site, but I do think that there is a design question that might be worth considering. I don't know if you all have explored ways to further set back above the fourth floor here in a way that doesn't impede on your overall project in any way, but I just will throw that out as a question for you. Maybe that might ameliorate some of the concerns that have been raised at the community level, not on density, but perhaps on feeling of the building on the in the mid block. I don't know if that's something you considered.
So even though I'm not the architect, Chair Grodnick, I'll address that. Is we will look at ways that we can have a feel of reducing density, even though we're not reducing the actual square feet, and we can get back to you in writing with some new concepts, if we can think of new concepts. And we are discussing some of those issues with the committee that I just described.
Great, I appreciate that. And then on the parking, so you all are pursuing a special permit process, which is underway, but will follow this action. Is that correct?
Yes. I neglected to mention that in my attempt to get through all my comments. You're absolutely right. We have started the process, and we are hopeful, your staff has worked very assiduously with us. We're hopeful that we'd be certified by the end of the year. And so it is following closely. We have agreed to eliminate the required parking. If you apply for the eliminator, it's up to you to decide if we can eliminate it.
Understood. But your intention is to pursue that special permit to completion.
Yes.
Okay. And then the last question for me is on the dynamic of the existing leases. So I understand that there are outstanding multiple decades long leases on sites, both on the east and west of this block. And that it has been a conversation with the council member and also perhaps between you all and HPD as to whether or not your client, Mr. Siegel, would relinquish those leases to allow for a 100% affordable project on either side or both sides of this block. Can you just say a little bit more about where that stands and how you expect that to be resolved in the context of the timeframe and process that we are in?
Yes, it's clear to us, as you know, as well as anybody in the city, the council member has the ultimate ability to approve this or not to approve it. And Councilman Ressler has made it clear he will not be approving this application unless Alano agrees to relinquish its leases. So Alano, being a realist, is going to have to relinquish its leases, assuming that the council member is okay with approving the rezoning application. Now, that process is exactly how we commit to do that, because it can't occur just by us shaking hands with people, is that we've been speaking with HPD and with DCAS about finding ways to commit to do what we just said in order for the council member to be comfortable to approve it. And we haven't come to a document yet, but we've started the process of speaking to DCAS and HPD about how we can bind ourselves to do what we said we would do.
Okay, great, thank you. Let me see what questions we have from the commission. We're gonna start with Commissioner Burney.
Thank you, and thank you guys for the presentation. I had a question about the retail on the ground floor on Bergen. I'm just wondering to what extent you expect to try to market retail on that stretch, because as you know, there's little tradition of retail on Bergen Street. Most of the retail is on Atlantic, where it's very strong. It's even quite weak on Third Avenue. And one wonders if you've done a market study and whether it's really viable to have retail on the ground floor in that project.
Mr. Birdie, I'm going to ask Rich Dillon, a representative of the ownership, to respond to that. You're muted, Rich. Rich, you're muted right now.
Got it. I got it. Thank you. Good morning, and thank you for having us before you. The question about what type of retail and to what kind of market exists for retail is a fair one. Third Avenue, our proximity, is a short distance away, feet away from this site where we would put retail. And in our opinion today, it is more neighborhood-oriented retail, the type that services the local foot clientele rather than any kind of destination. So it is not a credit tenant of sorts. It is more like the old-fashioned shoemaker, nail salon, those kind of things that service local community. And if there's not a market for that, we'll have to figure out such use. But it is not a Walmart or a big box type retail that you may be thinking of for Atlantic Avenue.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Osorio.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you very much for the presentation. This is very useful and for your responses to some of the questions. I had two quick questions. One was a quick follow-up to Mr. West regarding the creation of sustainability measures and resiliency measures. You know, I think that this it's never too late to understand. I mean, first of all, I commend you for the interest and to pursue LEED certification. That's critical right now. But also, I don't think it's never too late to talk a little bit about how do you plan to comply with local laws 94 and 92 regarding specifically on-site energy generation. And so I'm wondering if, you know, to what extent you've considered this, more or less what you anticipate is going to happen. And the reason why I ask this is because particularly given the configuration of the project, with the two public lots that are adjacent to it, and especially sort of like the prospect of generating future 100% affordable housing in the same block, this could be an opportunity to build infrastructure that will lead to greater energy efficiency and not to mention potential resilient energy distribution along the lines of a microgrid. In other words, your investment here is critical in terms of what's going to happen later. And so given the fact that you've expressed interest in working with HPD and so forth in configuring or consolidating rather affordable housing in the future, I would love to hear what are your thoughts in terms of the investments that should be made now to improve sustainability and resiliency measures, particularly regarding energy in the block.
Well, look, you're making a good point. I think this building is very well situated and would adapt itself well to solar panels. It's got a large roof. There are competing priorities for that roof. One would be tenant recreation. Another would be a green roof. But certainly we would evaluate its suitability for solar as well. And I think we would find that you could get quite a large solar array on the roof. As far as creating a microgrid, I guess that's maybe a little above my pay grade. I know energy storage is a big issue and there are still new codes being worked out about that. But I believe that the rate of progress that we're seeing with these issues being incorporated into market rate and affordable projects is quite, it's accelerated considerably over the last couple of years. And I think by the time this project gets built, there will be a whole new state of the art that has become somewhat typical for developments of this nature that would most likely find its way into a project like this. Maybe there's something we could do above and beyond that. I just don't think I'm at a stage where I could commit to a specific measure, but we will certainly be studying these things.
Understood. Thank you so much. And I really encourage you to do so. I think that this could be a great contribution to facilitating the type of affordable housing development that is being discussed for the larger, longer term. The other question is, I was wondering if you can explain a little bit, you know, what has been your response to some of the recommendations to explore affordability beyond MIH option 2, or your rationale at this point on the subject?
Well, this is Jay Sickle respond. I think our response to that would be with the 20,000 square feet of HPD lots. That would be as deep affordability as HPD wants, and that would produce 100 units of deep affordability. I think that has been our response to that issue.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Rambershad.
Thank you, and thank you for the presentation. Getting back to the parking for a second, when you revise or eliminate the, I guess, required parking, what are your plans to utilize that space, or how much space would you end up having? Do you have any ideas of what you're looking to do there? And just as a follow-up to Commissioner Osorio, I do agree it's never too late, and I would like to see, hopefully, when this comes back to us as a follow-up, that if you can start, I guess, indicating where these green initiatives are going to be putting forth on this building, if you can at least show that on some of the illustrative renderings, I'd appreciate that.
Okay, we will respond to that. The required parking, it's not so much what you would think, because almost all the required parking was being provided in the rear yard in a one-story building, which is allowed under zoning to have a one-story building. They're having stackers, and we're just eliminating that building. So in the floor area that was used to get to the back of the building, which is roughly 70 by 20, 1400 square feet, doesn't count as floor area, because accessory parking within 23 feet grade doesn't count as floor area. So we're not gaining any space other than to figure out how to use that 1400 square feet or so of space on the first floor, which it has to be for residential amenities or that type of thing. So there's not a big change in what our building will look like.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Before I go to Commissioner Gold, let me just note, if you are a member of the public who wishes to testify on this item, this is a good time to sign up. This is the moment, and here is the detail on the screen, how to participate. So have a look, and we welcome your input and your feedback. I make this reminder because as of this moment, I do not see any members of the public wishing to testify. So I just wanted to call that out briefly. With that, Commissioner Gold.
Thank you, Chair. So interesting presentation, very much appreciate it. Just really wanted to follow up on that one, I guess, sticking point of question on the parking piece. Two things. One, at this point, if you get the waiver, then is it an all or nothing, right? So if you get the waiver, is there no parking? And then at that point, you can figure out what amenities you put there.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Gold, I didn't understand your question.
So right now there's the question of if you'll get a waiver on the parking.
Yes.
If you do get that waiver, does that mean there's no parking whatsoever, or do you just reduce the amount of parking that you have? I'm just trying to think about that amenity space and how that all looks.
It means that we have no obligation to provide parking. If we thought we wanted 5-10 spaces for the commercial or for the community facility, we could do that, because mm-hmm. then the accessory parking, it wouldn't be required, but we could still do that.
So it sounds to me, and maybe I'm early on the question, but I'd just be curious on how you're thinking about it, Jay. Essentially, if we do get the waiver and if we do eliminate the parking, it sounds like that becomes space for amenities, right? For those who are in the facility, for in the building.
As I just explained, it's a very minor amount of additional space, because the parking was almost all the parking was going to be in the rear yard of 30 right. feet, which is now going to be open. They would instead of having a two lanes that lead one to and one from the parking, it would be how we use that about 1400 square feet of space, 70 feet deep by 20 feet wide. That would be it. And it isn't that it's going to require a big design change. We hadn't had the first floor worked out to any great degree. So there's not a lot of extra space.
Got it. I was more curious on, as I say, if there were alternative uses for that, for those who are, in the building that you had thought about that, contribute to the community. But it sounds like we're too early for all that.
Yeah, we are talking to the community, but the type of uses that they'd like to see in the community facility space, that's something we'll be talking about early next week when we meet. I think it's Monday, we're meeting with the community again.
Got it. So we're definitely too early. Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Eady.
Yeah, thank you. Jay, just following up on Commissioner Gold's question, you had mentioned that originally well, currently there's a building for the parking in the rear yard that if you got the waiver and you remove the parking, there would not be the need for that building. Is there another use in that rear yard which would be appropriate in terms of amenities for the buildings or anything like that?
Well, I think it would be open space that we're providing that people would be go out into the rear and enjoy the rear yard. Like what people do in their rear yard, right? They go in the rear and there'd be some amenities out in the rear yard. Yeah.
So the thought is space. If you didn't have the parking, you'd be able to provide open space for the residents.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Bozorg.
Hi, thank you for the presentation. I don't actually have a question. I thought it was a great, the material is great, presentation was great, and fellow commissioners have asked great questions. I just do want to echo my support for the chair's comments that it's important to maintain density as much as possible in transit-rich areas, or specifically on this site, but to find ways to respond to some of the concerns around the feel of that density. I think in the housing crisis we're experiencing that, finding ways to integrate density in transit-rich areas in a thoughtful way is incredibly important. So this could be an opportunity to demonstrate how that can be done thoughtfully for other communities as well.
Understood. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Osorio.
Thank you so much for the previous commissioners on the points about the parking. I just wanted to make a comment about this, which is that I think it's interesting and it's important to really think whether we need when and why we need additional parking in places like this. So I agree with you in the sense that I don't think that that's necessarily required here. But what I would love to encourage you is as you meet or as you prepare for the meeting with the community next week, you really engage in a conversation and a dialogue to explain, what is the importance and how can you use sort of that additional space in terms of local priorities and really take advantage of that opportunity to establish a stronger relationship with folks that don't necessarily agree with you on that point. But I think could greatly benefit from that space as long as you provide an open dialogue with them and really plan accordingly. In other words, create as many opportunities as possible for them to participate in the design of that space, the programming, and so forth.
Understood. Thank you.
Thanks, Commissioner. Okay. Other questions, comments from the commission? Okay. I see none. I also see no members of the public wishing to testify on this item. So I'm going to give a final call for that. And just going to take a close extra look. Okay, great. I see nobody. So I'm going to thank the applicant team for your presentation today. And we will close the hearing on this item at 280 Bergen Street, calendar numbers 9 and 10. Mr. Secretary, let me ask you if there is any other business pending before the commission today.
No, Chair Gorodnik. There is no additional business before the commission. However, I do have some public information I'd like to share.
Go ahead.
For those of you who were unable to or did not wish to testify, you can submit written comment online by selecting this hearing on the upcoming meetings page of the NYC Engage portal, through DCP's website, or by mailing your comments to City Planning Commission, Calendar Information Office, 120 Broadway, 31st floor, New York, New York, 10271.
Terrific. And with that, this remotely held meeting is adjourned. The time is now 10:44. Let me thank you all for your presence today. Applicant team, thank you. And certainly to the commission and the department staff for all their efforts to make this happen. Thank you all. We are adjourned.
Bye.
Thank you. Have a good afternoon.
Thank you.
Thank you.